Morning. If I didn't mess this up, there we go. Great. Well, let me start by saying that I believe that all Oregonians at the end of the day want the same thing. I think all of us want to be able to meet our basic needs with certainty and with dignity. I think we all want to have the opportunity to achieve our full potential. I think we want to work hard with the belief that hard work will be rewarded with a better life. I think we want to leave our kids better off than we were, both economically and environmentally. And I think we want to achieve a greater quality of life in harmony with and not at the expense of the majesty of the Pacific Northwest. These are Oregon aspirations. And in order to achieve them, we need to create an economy that works for all of us, regardless of where we live, who we love, or what language we speak at home. We need to create an economy that leads to equity and prosperity, an economy that creates living wage jobs and pathways that lead to those jobs, an economy that equips Oregonians with the education and skill and training they need to secure those jobs, and an economy that does so in concert with and not at the detriment of our natural environment. My goal as governor in this budget is to make sure that the resources are in place to make sure that we have an economy that does, in fact, work for all of us. Over the past 4 years, we've made some very difficult decisions in this state to improve how tax dollars are spent. We have reduced the cost of health care by shifting our focus from after-the-fact acute care to prevention and wellness and community-based management of chronic conditions. We've eliminated the need to build new prisons by investing directly in the safety of our communities. And we've taken steps to reduce the long-term cost of our public employee pension system. Together, these reforms have created a tremendous opportunity for Oregon, an opportunity to reinvest in our children, our families, our schools, our communities, and our rural economies. The budget that I'm proposing today is built on principles rather than on programs. It aims to align our state resources with the goal of, by 2025, all Oregon high school students end up with a diploma or an equivalent, and that 80% of them go on to get a baccalaureate degree, a technical certificate, or an associate's degree. This is important to ensure that prosperity reaches every corner of our state, and also because every Oregonian deserves an equal opportunity to reach for the American dream. For too long, Oregon has built its budgets in the moment, by the moment, and for the moment. And 4 years ago, we changed all that by developing a 10-year budget frame that actually looks at how the investments we make today impact Oregonians a decade from now. And I'm here to tell you that Oregon is on the pathway to a sustainable budget. We are on track by 2019-21 biennium to erase the structural budget deficit that's plagued us for 25 years since the passage of ballot measure 5 in 1990. And thanks to the reforms we've made in healthcare, in public safety, and in our public pension system, not only will we erase that structural budget deficit, but we are on track to have a structural budget surplus for the first time in the 21-23 biennium. This chart is the healthcare budget, and it shows you what the expenditures would have been without the reforms we've made in Medicaid and now extending those to PEB and to and hopefully to OEB. And this is projected today. This delta here is about $5 billion. The total savings are probably higher than 10. When you take that and incorporate it into our general fund lottery fund budget, you can see that in the 1921 biennium, and this includes healthcare savings, PERS savings, and savings in public safety, we actually have the inflection point where we have eliminated the structural budget deficit and begin to build a structural surplus in the 21-23 biennium. And that is tremendously good news for Oregon, because these transformational changes create a significant savings that allow us to make much needed investments in a wide variety of things. So let me start with investments in our children, families, and education. With our attention focused forward, I'm proposing today that we fundamentally change the way we invest in education in Oregon. Over the past 4 years, we've sought to break down silos and create a seamless educational continuum from early childhood through post-secondary education and training, and align policy and governance and funding across that continuum. To prepare all Oregonians to compete globally and to prosper locally, we need to make sure that we produce young men and women who have the capacity to think critically, to imagine, to create, and to innovate. And to accomplish that, the state's role in education has got to change from that of simply a passive funder of enrollment to an active strategic investor in outcomes. And that's exactly what this budget seeks to do. Instead of simply focusing on a number, we seek to set goals and then ensure that our educational system achieves them. This budget is focused on the key pathways to student success. First, the pathway to kindergarten readiness and third grade reading. Secondly, the pathway to high school and post-secondary completion. And third, the pathway to connect education to careers. Education accounts for 50% of the general fund dollars in this budget, a $9.4 billion investment in our schools, our community colleges, and our universities. This historic investment is structured to break down the institutional barriers that have been corrosive to opportunities for our children, particularly students of color and those who live in poverty. My budget puts roughly $7.2 billion into K through 12 expenditures. And that is an historic investment in our public schools. To put that into perspective, that is $1.5 billion more than we spent on K through 12 when I was elected in 2011. On early learning, this budget targets over $400 million where it really counts, establishing a clear pathway from age 3 to grade 3 with statewide investments in literacy and to develop the full potential of both our teachers and our children. And with these investments, we believe that over 90% of our children will be reading at level in third grade within 5 years. On the pathway from high school to post-secondary education, this budget puts resources towards helping school districts make sure that English language learners are on track. It also makes a $500 million investment in the Community College Support Fund, the largest investment in that fund since the start of the Great Recession. Finally, we've invested $626 million in the Public University Support Fund. I believe that it needs at least another $50 million because of the changes in the formula we're trying to implement, and I will work with legislative leadership to capture the expected increase in revenues over this next biennium and make sure we get those resources to our public universities. And to support every student's journey from the halls of school to the world of work, the budget invests $13 million to revitalize career and technical education, and it invests $15 million to expand math and science and engineering and technology education. In conjunction with Oregon's tribes and other parties, the Oregon Investment Board is leading a $1.5 million tribal attendance pilot project for Native American students through stronger partnerships between schools and parents and families in the tribal community. As you know, chronic absenteeism is very significant among Native American students, and this pilot aims to turn that around. So together, these investments will help break down institutional barriers and make sure that all students get an equal opportunity to thrive and to prosper. This is a true equity budget and seeks to fundamentally begin to close the achievement gap. In addition, I'm proposing today policies and investments to make work pay. This budget continues our earnest efforts to address the disparities that continue to exist in Oregon, ethnic disparities, geographic, demographic, economic disparities, that demonstrate the unevenness of our prosperity in the state and the unevenness of our economic recovery. By consciously focusing on equity as a driver of budget investments, we can make progress addressing these underlying disparities while at the same time continuing to make important reforms and important investments in education, in healthcare, in public safety, and in Oregon's economy. The budget includes tax relief for Oregonians seeking to work their way out of low-wage jobs, to ensure that hard work is actually rewarded with a better life, to ensure that when you get more wages, when your income goes up, you actually have more money, not less money in your pocket, and that you aren't trapped in poverty even as you seek to escape the social safety net. With the creation of the Working Family Additional Tax Credit, this budget will help smooth out the income cliff for those trying to move up the income ladder between $9.10 an hour and $17.10 an hour. The budget also includes $55 million to expand the availability and the quality of employment-related daycare, which is a key support to help low-income Oregonians, particularly working mothers, move up the income ladder and out of poverty. The budget also includes $100 million in bonds that are targeted primarily to increase housing for homeless families with children. The state, as a financer of housing, can and should play a larger role in addressing this need in partnership with counties and with nonprofit organizations that build and operate low-income housing to address the needs of the homeless. Now, the cost-saving actions that we have taken in healthcare and public safety and in our pension system have given us the ability to invest more taxpayer dollars into programs and priorities that better leverage and connect state dollars with private and not-for-profit and philanthropic dollars to get a better leverage and return on outcome. So our rapidly maturing regional solutions centers and regional solution committees are making smart return driven investments that will bring much needed relief to struggling rural economies. This budget includes, in fact, over $200 million of investments that are directly targeted to benefit rural Oregon. These investments target both near-term opportunities for much needed job creation as well as long-term investments designed to create the tools necessary to prepare our rural communities for the realities of the 21st century economy. In the near term, we have put additional resources towards our funding our forest collaboratives that continue to create and retain jobs in our timber industry, and we've invested in rural infrastructure. The long-term budget invests in a forest science research center at Oregon State University to seek to find ways to expand the market for Oregon's wood products, and we've put $50 million toward water-related infrastructure, which is obviously critical to agriculture and ranchers in the state of Oregon. The budget also includes $25 million invested to set aside $2 million each for each of our 11 economic development regions, regardless of size, so that these communities can launch locally identified projects to address multiple outcomes in health, early learning, education, workforce, and economic development. The budget also includes $40 million in existing and new programs for Oregon's innovation and entrepreneurship community. We know that 70% of the jobs created in the future in this state will come from companies and businesses that already reside in our state. So through investments like the $29.3 million in the Oregon Investment Council, this will bolster Oregon startup companies and actually help the entrepreneurs who are building these new businesses. The budget continues our healthcare investments in our new coordinated care model by applying that model to all healthcare purchased by the state of Oregon, which encompasses 1.3 million Oregonians in the Oregon Health Plan, the Public Employees Benefit Board, and the Educators Oregon Educators Benefit Board. These investments will continue to save money while keeping Oregonians healthier. And while continuing the healthcare transformation work at hand, this budget also begins to heighten the attention on mental health services. All too often, and very often with tragic consequences, people with mental health needs fall into our criminal justice system rather into our healthcare system. So this budget invests an additional $53 million in mental, community health, mental and addiction services. It promotes encouraging development of collaborative approaches for mental health treatment and prioritizes community health programs. This budget is the framework that will continue our efforts to strengthen Oregon's economy and Oregon's environment. Now, in order to achieve the outcomes in this budget and the investments that we've made, every investment identified has got to get the best possible return. So to do that, to ensure that we implement this budget correctly, I'm convening four budget implementation teams around four key budget priority areas. The first one is early learning and third grade reading. The second is career and technical education and STEM. The third is rural economic development, and finally, mental health. Over the next few months, these teams will provide guidance to my administration so that agencies and stakeholders are actually aligned around the outcomes, that we maximize return to the taxpayers, and that we drive stronger outcomes. Next week, I'll be announcing the co-chairs and the membership of these four implementation teams, as well as the specific task that we have charged them with. As I've said many times, my career in public service has been based on the belief that we are all in this together, that there are things we can do as a community and as a society and as a state to lift us all up, to improve our lives and the lives of our friends and our neighbors, and that we don't have to leave anybody behind. Today, we have an opportunity to deliver on that belief. Today, we have an opportunity to make smart investments in Oregon. So to summarize, this budget fulfills our commitment to full-day kindergarten for every child in this state. It begins to make investments and system changes to ensure that all children are reading at level in third grade. It continues our work to strengthen Oregon's commitment to ensuring that every student has the skill they need to find and hold a rewarding job, and it demonstrates our commitment to reducing poverty, to increasing prosperity, and increasing equity across the state. Let me simply close by saying that in a national political environment that seems to celebrate conflict over compromise, I think Oregon is unique. We live in a state that is defined not by our gridlock, but by our accomplishment. Throughout our state's history, we have come together to do great things, to do hard things, and we have that opportunity again today to reinvent how we invest in education, to make our communities safer, to make our citizens healthier, to make our state fair and more prosperous, and to invest in rural Oregon. What the famous Western author Wallace Stegner believed is possible through cooperation, I believe is possible here in Oregon to create a society to match our scenery. I look forward to doing that together. Thank you. Peter.
In addition to an expanded earned income tax credit, and could you tell us what level you propose that at? Are there any other tax breaks that are that you propose to extend since the legislature has a cycle?
We've actually extended all of the tax credits, including the earned income tax credit. So we've maintained that. And the two big changes to deal with the cliff are the significant increase in employment-related daycare and the working family additional tax credit, which essentially buys down your cost of daycare.
Governor, it seems like, obviously after the election, your party gained more seats in the legislature. Same time during the election, some revelations about your life and your First Lady kind of made it more difficult for you to appear in public and to speak to the press. Are you hopeful that you'll be able to do what you want to do in this coming legislative session?
There are two questions or one question there? Look around. This looks like pretty much looks like the press to me. The second question is, yes, I think I am going to be able to do what I want to do. This budget reflects, I think, common priorities. I think these are priorities that are held by Republicans and Democrats alike. Most of the major legislation that we've passed over the years in this state has not been done on strictly partisan lines. The health care reform, workers' comp reform, the changes to education, many of our major environmental laws. So I believe that you'll see the state come together as it did after the 2011 election cycle, which was also very divisive, and that we'll have a very productive session.
How can you assure the educational outcomes that you're looking for out of this budget?
Well, I think that if you look at let's look at two areas. The first one is the focus on age 3 to grade 3. We already have a pretty well-developed early learning system out there. Our hubs will be fully out by the middle of this year. And they're directly engaging all the key players, not just governmental agencies, but community-based organizations that are necessary to ensure that kids are ready for kindergarten when they get to kindergarten. We have an $85 million literacy package that basically makes sure that full-day kindergarten isn't a one-off, but it's actually connected to early learning and also connected with grades 1 through 3. It's based on very, very good evidence, and we do believe that we'll be seeing by the end of this biennium a discernible increase in early childhood, and that we will be on track to get 90% of our kids reading at level in third grade. The second one that I think we'll be able to show some early return on is better connecting high school students with the world of work through career and technical education, and through exposure to computer science and STEM opportunities. And you know, in many cases, children drop out of high school because they don't see any relevance between what they're doing and the world of work. And this focused initiative on CTE and STEM will hopefully begin to address that.
Do you have any new revenue in your budget?
There is no new revenue except for we have capped gain share. The gain share, I think, what is it, at 45, George? 45 million, that picks up some revenue. And then we've extended a liquor tax. So I think those are the only two new revenue components.
Hospital tax?
The hospital tax, we have not included in the budget, but we will propose that, yes. Yep, that will be, hopefully we'll get that through the billing early.
Have you had a chance to look at the transportation financing package proposed by a consortium of local governments, environmental groups, and highway users?
Yes, I have, and actually, it's in sort of a straw person mode now. They've got several elements to it, and they're circulating those to the various stakeholders and trying to see where there is consensus. I do believe we need some short-term resources into our transportation system. We're falling way behind on critical maintenance. That's very, very important, and I would certainly support that effort this session if we can build the political emphasis behind it. But we launched just last week our long-term transportation visioning effort, which is really looking out three decades and asking what do we want our transportation system to look like across all modes, and then how will we pay for it? We know that the gas tax is a declining source of revenue for transportation infrastructure. So we need to act both short-term but have a clear long-term vision.
This budget mentions nearly $100 million for seismic rehabilitation of schools and emergency service buildings. Does that include, or do you also support the seismic project proposed for the Capitol building?
I'm not sure that that has, did we include that in there? Is there a place, I think there's a placeholder for that. George?
We don't actually make recommendations about packages the legislature or the judicial branch is proposing, but instead we've left about $200 million unspent in our bonding capacity.
You talked last year about doing tax reform in 2015. So is that still on the table, and what's the plan for that?
So I didn't spend all that time and energy helping get those ballot measures off to squander this little window we have between now and 2016. So that's an issue that we continue to need to look at. The one thing that we did find out together from the polling is that passing a retail sales tax is just not as a non-starter here in the state of Oregon. We do need, tax reform means different things to different people. To some people, it means raising a whole lot more money. For some people, it means making modifications to address the cliff for low-income Oregonians or capital gains tax relief at the top end. So we need to sit down and have a conversation about what we think is possible. If we don't agree on some changes to the tax system, what I predict will happen is you will see in the 2016 election cycle a repeat of what we almost saw in 2014. There'll be some 66, 67 type measures focused strictly on raising revenue. There'll be other measures that are focused on undermining the power of unions in the state of Oregon, and I don't think we want to go there. So I can't tell you what it looks like, but I think there is a bargain there that can be crafted. And personally, I also think we need to take a hard look at how the kicker operates. I have no problem with a system that prevents the state from building up a huge surplus. The problem with the kicker is that it's the entire portion over the forecast that is rebated, not just the portion over 2%. And so what happens is that today, if our revenue forecast grows by $30 million because the economy is good, we lose $300 million. There isn't a family or business in this country that operates like that. In good times, you should have the ability to invest in your human capital, invest in infrastructure. And so those are that is another area that I think we need to have a serious conversation about.
To follow up on that, how much more money do you have to work with this biennium as opposed to the previous biennium? And what impact will the possibility that we'll get a kicker have on that?
So I think it's about $1.6 billion in revenue growth from last buy-in to this buy-in. I mean, the way we put this budget together is we flat-funded everything. We basically gave every agency what they got last time and then looked at how to reallocate that revenue growth in ways that were consistent with the policy objectives we wanted to achieve. The kicker, if it kicks, we would lose probably around $250 million. And so we'd have to work with the legislature to figure out where in this budget we could make $250 worth of reductions. And obviously that would make this not nearly as robust a budget as it is. We hope that doesn't happen, but that would be how we would have to deal with it.
Governor, during the November 10th OEIB meeting, the president of the OEA raised concerns that the strategic investments weren't necessarily focused on reducing class sizes. I'm wondering what your thoughts on our class sizes. Do you think they have a detrimental effect on education for children, and does your budget address that issue?
So yes, I do believe class size is a detriment to learning, particularly at the lower grades. The total investment in K through 12, including early learning, is over $7.2 billion. There is enough resource in there to actually lower class sizes if the districts choose to do so, and I would recommend that they do and that they focus on, the early learning. I guess I would differ, and I don't want to characterize what the president of the OEA said, but class size is not the only factor. If you have kids who arrive in kindergarten who, because of socioeconomic issues, are not ready to learn, who can't recognize numbers, who can't recognize letters, who haven't been read to, it doesn't matter how small the class size is, that child's going to struggle. And for too long, we have defined education in Oregon, primary and secondary education in Oregon, as starting in kindergarten. And it doesn't. If you want to get rid of the disparities in our state, if you want our kids to thrive, if you want to reduce high school, if you want to increase high school completion rates, you've got to start investing in those kids very, very early. So I view primary and secondary education starting at birth and going to 12th grade. And we need to define it as that. And we need to start now, because if we simply fund full-day kindergarten as a one-off, you're going to continue to have all these kids that are going to come into full-day kindergarten not ready, who are not going to be reading at level at third grade, and who are going to drop out. And so we have to be a bit more holistic, I think, and intellectually honest about our investments.
And just to clarify, of that $7.2 billion, how much of that is in the state school fund specifically?
So $6.9 is in the state school fund. If we're successful in moving the Oregon Educators Benefit Board into the new care model, that frees up another $80 million in buying capacity, just as PERS did. So that gets you very close to $7 billion. Then there is an additional, I believe it's $267 million that's invested directly in K-12 and in our early literacy a package that takes that total investment to about 7.25.
You said it's 267?
Another 200, and I think it's about 267 million.
And so in a November 4th draft of strategic investment priorities, there was, I believe, 400.1 million for K through 12. Is that?
The 400 million includes a whole host of things. It does include the $135 million for early learning. It includes STEM, the CTE, high school completion, and I believe we have full-day kindergarten in there as well. Yeah, full-day kindergarten's included in that. So we can give you an updated copy of that sheet. We've pared it down some based on the realities of the budget, but we can show you afterwards. We've got a sheet that'll break each one of those down.
There's some slight changes from the draft.
Yes, there were. And the other issue that will be, I think, controversial is that we have made some changes within the formula. You know, the formula basically rewards enrollment, not even attendance. And we have changed the formula in three significant ways. One is to create incentives for kids to be on track in ninth grade, particularly underserved populations. We've made a formula change to incent moving children out of an ELL program. Right now, there's no incentive to do that, and the evidence, the research shows that a child who actually leaves an ELL program is much more likely to graduate, even over students who haven't been in an ELL program and who don't have who have English as their home language. And then third, we've created a formula change to incent bringing career and technical education back to our high schools.
You mentioned in 2019 the budget deficit would be erased and we'd go on to a surplus. Do you have the number of what the deficit is now and what's kind of the most positive change that's...
There's no question that the healthcare changes were clearly the biggest driver. I mean, the estimates right now, and these are based on... we have to update them based on the new forecast, but was in excess of $4 billion savings just in the health care. That's assuming the new care model encompasses the health plan, people on PEB, and people on OEB. The other significant change, obviously, were the changes in the public employees retirement system and the changes we made in public safety to avoid the new prison. Now, the two things that could derail that are, obviously, if the economy crashes, although we are getting quite a bit of resource in our rainy day fund and our educational stability fund, or if the kicker kicks, which is why I think if we're interested in actually having, you know, a long-term structural budget surplus, you can't do that without addressing in some way the way the kicker is currently constructed.
Thank you.
Governor, could you speak to the statewide paid sick leave policy, how you would help to implement that, and what kind of dollars you're going to put that?
Well, that, we don't, that's not included in our budget. That's obviously a policy. I would support that. I do believe that if we're going to have paid sick leave, which I think makes imminent sense, it needs to be done at the statewide level, not city by city. It needs to be done in a way that, because that's easier, I think, to address for particularly smaller businesses. And it has to be done in a way that accommodates existing collective bargaining agreements and doesn't, you know, have untoward consequences like simply having a different part of the benefit package pushed down. So I know that that will be a proposal coming into the legislature, and certainly I'll be engaged in trying to craft that in a way that that makes it work.
If you support a targeted capital gains tax cut, why is that not in this budget document?
It's an expenditure, just like you know, we haven't passed that yet, The same reason the hospital tax isn't built into the budget, but I proposed a targeted capital gains tax reduction for reinvestment in Oregon businesses in 2011, and we'll definitely introduce that into the discussion during the session.
Will it be on the same scale as the 2011?
Probably, and you know, it really depends on. I mean, depends on the budget, because that's the tax expenditure.
Do you expect marijuana tax income to have any impact?
Well, I don't think it's going to have a huge impact on a $7 billion education budget, for example. My biggest concern really is making sure that implementing legislation is in place to make sure that this works and doesn't create problems. I don't mean in any way that we would circumvent the will of the voters, but I do think as you go through the bill, there are legitimate questions we need to ask. And I would be very surprised if there wasn't some kind of implementing legislation to make sure that we have learned from the experiences in Washington and Colorado, and to make sure that we have the appropriate framework of public safety and public health legislation in place to make sure that this works. We've got 15 months before it goes into effect, so we do have an opportunity to take a hard look at it.
Time for two more questions.
Are there any policy changes, eligibility changes for the programs, the safety net programs?
We have maintained the, no, the answer is no. But we have, as you know, we're reinvesting TANF savings that we've got to kind of redesign that program to make it more effective in getting people to work. And we have made increases in obviously, employment-related daycare is a huge, hugely important program.
Do you expect some pushback on the fact that none of the new education dollars are invested in the public universities' initial allocation? I know there's been discussion that people want to up that this cycle.
Well, yeah, we have. As I said, we've got about $626 million. Their high point, I guess, was about $690 million back in 2005. So if you wanted to equate the $500 million in the Community College Support Fund, in the Public University Support Fund, we're about $66 million short. And that's why I said that I think it's very important we need to try to get at least another $50 million in there. The university presidents who I met with last week are working with the HEC to work on some formula changes, more of an outcome-based allocation. And obviously, it's easier to do that when you have some additional resources in the budget. So I'll work diligently. I know that at least Representative Buckley is very interested in that issue as well. Great. Thank you.